commentator, radio man. Could you do it?
Yeah.
Well, Luigi Tavirri, my personal favourite TT rider. The crowds love you still. Why do you think that is?
Sorry?
Why do you think everybody loves Luigi Tavirri?
I don't know. Everybody loves me, but I feel the people likes me. So this is for me very nice. And it's so many years ago I was here for racing, and still the people knows me. I must say I'm happy to the people. He gave me still the
applause.
Yep.
Now you rode here on the Clips course and the mountain course.
Yes.
With wins on both.
In the beginning, on the Clips course with the 125s.
Yes.
And then later on with the big bikes, yeah.
But sometimes on the continent you rode sidecar passenger too.
In the beginning I was also sidecar passenger with my brother. My brother was the driver. And later on with Hans Haldemann. He was a very famous sidecar rider. I make with him passenger and I drive the solo bikes.
But over here, when you beat Jim Redman, was one of your best races in the 125. 62, was it? When you beat Jim?
I don't know which year, but I remember still the race. And of course, was for me nice. I was in the front of him, but I remember we have a very hard race together. And this is, I think, this is in my remember, yeah.
And you rode the 125 twins and the fours and the five cylinder.
Yes, this is correct, yeah.
Which was the best?
The most attractive bike was, of course, the five cylinder in 1966. This was a very, very special bike.
And the little 50cc TT bike?
Yeah, too. But the 50 also was very difficult for driving.
Yes.
The four-stroke and the very small bike, not so easy.
Little brakes?
Yeah, the same as the bicycle.
Push bike brakes.
Yeah.
Okay, you're very welcome. Thank you for talking to us.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll give a free DVD. Yeah. All right. Well, Tommy Roberts, a pleasure to see you back in the Isle of Man as well. And the years roll by, but the people that have turned out to here now, as I just said to Luigi Tavirri, your former Honda teammate, they seem to love the old riders and the old bikes with a fervour.
Of course they do, and this is one of the reasons we said that Luke keeps us going. Luke and people like him. And of course, Jeff, you and I have known each other for a long, long time. And the people today actually are as keen as they were then. But what I am finding today is they're coming up and saying, thank you for all the fun you gave us 40 years ago. And to me, it's wonderful to see that. It really is. It's lovely. They didn't have the guts to do it in those days.
Now, you rode the small bikes, the Hondas, as small as the 50, but also went up to the big Hondas.
Yep.
And which do you sort of remember with the most fondness?
Funny enough, I know it sounds strange, but I'll never ever forget my first ride on the 125 Twin. It was something very, very special. When you've been riding Bull Tacos and James's and Francis Barnett's and NSU, to get on a 125 Twin was really something very special. But then when I got on the Exotica, like the four-cylinder 125s, the 254s, beautiful. And we've still got a very close association with Honda.
But ironically, of course, you've got a win on a Yamaha.
That's true, yes, it's very true, but it's not a bad thing. It keeps your name in with both companies.
And in fact, you sort of switched between the companies. There was no resentment between them, was there?
Not
it was
whatsoever.
Just a case of which rider was the best for the particular class.
That's right, and I think also you had to fit in with the companies because you had to do their wishes while they were employing you. They were the bosses.
But the early Yamahas, the air-cooled ones, were a bit dodgy, weren't they?
I'll never forget mine seizing on the way to... the way to Ballycrane one morning, and it seized at about 120 mile an hour, and it seized very, very quickly. And I was so frightened, I walked all the way back to the start from Ballycrane.
Just to calm down.
Just to calm down.
Yeah. But the win now is a few years ago, but a win is a win, and you look back on that with great affection. And now we've lost Peter Neal, of course.
Yes.
I heard you and him talking, and he is a big loss to the Isle of Man as well.
Big loss. Peter was a lovely, lovely man. He was, as you were rightly saying in your interviews and stuff yesterday, his memory was incredible, because not only had he all the written work, but he had to memorize it. And Peter could come out with things. Well, you remember the year when there were very few starters, and Peter was handing over to me about 3 minutes before he should have, because he'd run out of things to talk about. I was handing over to you, giving you about 10 minutes to talk, because I'd run out of things to talk about. Terrific years.
People just don't remember those days. I mean, yesterday there wasn't a moment to spare with David Jeffries. What do you think of that, running at 126 mile an hour?
Marvellous. And I think he's even got more in him. You know, that's what's sort of important.
That was on the slowing down lap.
Yeah, it's terrific, that.
Well, we remember your rides on Honda, Suzuki, Yamaha, and Sealy's, and the whole lot with affection, and thanks for talking to us.
Thank you for your friendship over the years, Jeff.
Thank you, Tommy. Well, Ralph, it's been 1 or 2 years since you were riding around here on Hondas as well, but you went on to take TT Victory in the 50s and, of course, went on to the World Championships. And people remember this. They know everything about you, even all these years later, don't they?
Oh, yes. People around here have got very, very long memories, I think, you know, because I haven't actually competed in the TT since 1967, which is a long time ago, 35 years.
I'm finding that the people seem to know more about the riders in some cases than the riders know themselves.
Indeed, yes. People have been coming to me and say, oh, I remember when you done this and you done that and you done the other thing. I have no recollection. I didn't think I was that daft, but still, must have been at one time.
But you made your name on Norton's, particularly at Dundrod, and then went on to the TT, and I think first on the Honda Twins, the silver sort of semi-production bike, production race bikes.
Well, actually, I joined Honda in 1964. Prior to that, I was riding 350 and 500 Mike Norton's, as you correctly say. And Honda wanted me to ride 50s and 125s. And it took a lot of adapting for me, actually, to get used to riding, particularly the 50, which was very, very difficult to ride. Matter of fact, I broke quite a few inches before I managed to master it. And the first race I actually finished in a 50 was here at the TT in 1964, when I finished second to Hugh Anderson. Prior to that, I broke every engine that I got hands on. So I learned how to ride the thing around the Isle of Man TT, you could say.
Yeah, it was hard to ride because of the narrow power band of the engine.
Yes, and it was very, very easy to over-rev. And if you over-revved it by 200 or 300 revs, boom, it just disintegrated. And something that revved at 21,000 RPM, as you can imagine, if it did break, it wasn't a minor break. You know, it was just a pile of shrapnel, and trying to figure out what broke first was practically impossible.
The top of the pistons in those were about the size of what was then a shilling piece, wasn't it?
Something about that big, whoever big that is.
Extraordinary that they would do that, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But your win came here on the 50.
Yes, in 1966, I lapped at 86 miles an hour on a 50.
Unbelievable.
Which was quite quick in those days.
And of course, with no 50 race now, you are the lap record holder in perpetuity.
Yes, indeed. Which is handy, you know, to have something that's still written in the record books, I suppose.
Unfortunately, they don't send you a pension based on that.
No, indeed not.
Great days, though.
Indeed, yes.
Great days.
But I still have the silver replica, okay, with the fastest lap at home, so
okay,
there's
well,
something to
remind
you of.
Proud of it, too.
Indeed, yes.
Okay, thanks a lot.
You're more than welcome. Thank you.
Thanks. All right. Yeah, Sammy Miller. Well, Sammy Miller, everybody thinks that you're most famous for trials, but when you get to the Isle of Man here, trials is more or less forgotten, and it's Sammy Miller riding Mondial, CZ, in the TT.
And the NFC, of course.
Okay, yeah.
Well, when you're born in Belfast, everybody goes road racing. Yeah. Everybody's got to do the TT, and I remember vividly coming over on a trials BSA to learn the then Eclipse circuit, and I spent a fortnight on the island on my own in digs in Douglas, and learned the circuit, walked the circuit, and of course the first lap in practice I was very quick, and all of a sudden the warning bells went up, and it helped me get a Works NSU ride.
You were on Terry Hill's NSUs originally,
yeah,
though,
yeah,
were you?
Yeah, and we got, unfortunately I was leading in the first, as you know, I was leading Ubi Alley, and the big end gave out of the Craig, and that was very disappointing. I was very wet. I remember the black, the dye of my leathers went through, and I was a black man for about a week.
When you go around the Clips course now, you can hardly believe that that was used, and particularly for a World Championship Sidecar Grand Prix.
I came down last night from the Craig when I was watching a production race, and I couldn't believe it, like, you know.
So narrow, isn't
it? So narrow, like, dropped down into Honkinland, you know. But really, it was some very good racing there. Very good racing.
The Mondial and the CZ were very different bikes, weren't they?
Yes, the Mondial was double overhead. Well, both were double overhead cam, fully fared, of course, which were highly exciting in the wind. You know, we got blown all over the road. I remember coming into Onchan and, you know, you were sort of using all the road on a straight road.
But with the full streamlining on as well, it limited the brakes, didn't it?
Not really. We had plenty of air scoops on, but it gave, you know, quite a lot of, you know, you were good for another 20 miles an hour, 25 miles an hour, top maximum speed, but full fairing. And, of course, the rear tail section too.
Yeah, it was.
And they banned those in 57. They were too dangerous because people were getting swept off the road, going down the straight.
So you went down into the CZ, and that was a dolphin fairing, I think, wasn't it?
Yeah, with a leading link fork. And we've got one in the museum now, which is quite interesting. Bring back happy memories. We've got a little section for Jawas and CZs. I had a very, very good relationship with the CZ factory.
Okay, well, you never quite won a TT. You were within a quarter of a mile of it.
One,
but clipped the pavement then out of five, not like a trials man.
No, big five there, and pushed it into fourth or something, but that was a big disappointing.
What actually happened then, do you think? Did you just slip away on a patch of tar or what?
I reckoned I couldn't get it, when I came off, I couldn't get it back into gear again, and I think I went into neutral, and just as I approached Governors, and I was just too quick, you know.
Well, it's a great record to look back at, those shots of you pushing it in there. It shows the endeavour you made. And then you went on to the trials then, and the Bull Tacker was forever associated with your name.
Yeah, well, and I managed to win 10 Manx two-day trials on the trot, which wasn't too bad for a young'un, you know. And I have very happy memories of the island, and always great enthusiasm and great people and great biking. And I really envy you living over here, because now there's so many events on, and no travelling, no traffic queues, and every weekend you can get a ride somewhere, whether it's trials, sand racing, scrambles, or motocross, road racing. Wonderful.
Oh, well, maybe we'll welcome you to our shows permanently before too long. Thanks very much.
All the best, yeah.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Thanks a lot.